Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Rosie Result by Graeme Simsion, narrated by Dan O'Grady.
Simsion, read by Daniel O'Grady. Chapter 1. I was standing on one leg shucking oysters when the problems began. If I'd not been a scientist, conscious of the human propensity to see patterns where they do not exist, I might have concluded that I was being punished by some deity for the sin of pride. Earlier that afternoon, I had been completing a performance review form and was presented with the question, "What do you consider to be your key strengths?" It was a vague construction which specified neither context nor level of generalization. Expertise in genetics was the obvious answer, but this was implied by the job title, Professor of Genetics. My knowledge of myxoid liposarcoma would soon be of minimal relevance, as my research project in that area was nearing completion. Objectivity and intelligence might suggest that I thought some academics lacked these attributes, which was true, but probably tactless. I needed to avoid tactlessness. I was still searching for an answer when Rosie arrived home. "What are you doing in your pajamas?" she said. "Preparing dinner, which I'm time-sharing with solving a problem, and single leg dips." "I mean, why are you wearing pyjamas?" "There was a minor cooking accident involving an exploding chestnut. I was attempting to speed up the process by increasing the temperature, hence the oil on various surfaces. I indicated the splashes on the ceiling. My clothes were also affected. I avoided further loss of time by switching directly to pyjamas rather than putting on an intermediate costume."
"You haven't forgotten we've got Dave and Sonia for dinner?"
"Of course not. It's the second Wednesday of the month, the day I changed my toothbrush head." Rosie performed her impression of my voice, a sign that she was in a good mood.
"Guests, pyjamas, not a valid combination."
"Dave and Sonia have seen me in pyjamas on the Cape Canaveral trip."
"Don't remind me."
"If there's time to change my costume, I should devote it to the performance review form. I explained a problem."
"Just write whatever you wrote last year."
"I didn't do it last year, or the year before, or..."
12 years at Columbia and you haven't had to do a performance review."
"I don't complete the form. There's always some higher priority task. Unfortunately, David Borenstein insisted if it's not on his desk tomorrow, he's threatened to take some unspecified punitive action."
"You're stuck on the question about strengths?"
"Correct."
"Just say, problem solving, it's a good answer and it won't come back to bite you. If you don't find a cure for cancer, they're not going to say, but you said you were a good problem solver."
"You've encountered the same question?"
"Only about 20 times in the last month."
Rosie's current medical research project was also finishing, and she was seeking a more senior position. It was proving difficult, as most roles involve clinical work. Her argument was,
"I'm a crap physician, but a good researcher. Why waste time on stuff I'm not good at?"
I had applied the same logic to the performance review form. "Presumably, you also gave the optimum answer," I said. "Problem solving."
"I usually say team player, but in your case,
it might have returned to bite me." Rosie laughed.
"I'll finish filling it out and you'll have time to make yourself respectable. Teamwork, see?"
She must have noticed my expression.
"You can review it when I'm done."
As I processed the remaining oysters, I reflected on Rosie's suggestion. It was satisfying that my partner recognized an attribute that I'd not previously articulated. I was a good problem solver. I had the advantage of an atypical, the word used by others was weird, approach to analysing and responding to situations. Over my 25-year career, it had enabled me to overcome day-to-day obstacles and initiate major breakthroughs. It had also delivered benefits in my personal life. At 20, I had been a computer science student, socially incompetent even by the standards of 20-year-old computer science students, with zero prospect of finding a partner. Now, largely due to the deliberate application of problem-solving techniques, I was employed in a stimulating and well-paid job, married to the world's most beautiful and compatible woman, Rosie, and father to a talented and happy 10-year-old child, Hudson, who was showing signs of becoming an innovative problem-solver himself. I had identified Rosie's biological father from 65 candidates,